are some things I may not know. There are some places I can't go. But I am sure of this one thing, that God is real, for I can feel Him deep within. Oh, yes, God is real. He's real in my soul. Yes, God is real, for He has washed and made me whole. His love for me is like pure gold. Yes, God is real, for I can feel Him in my soul. Yes, God is real. He's real in my soul. Yes, God is real, for He has washed and made me whole. His love for me is like pure gold. Yes, God is real, for I can feel Him in my soul. Amen. Our Father and our God, we come to You tonight, dear Father God, with one thing on our mind, and that is to live, dear Father, to learn so that we can live according to Your righteous and holy way, dear Father. And so we ask that if You are, Father God, be true to Your own word, dear Father God, because You said where there are two or three gathered together, there You would be in our midst, dear Father. And so we ask that if You would, please, to be in our presence as You have promised, dear Father God, so that Your will might be done according to Your righteous and holy word that You have given us, dear Father God, that we might grow by. I personally ask that if You would, please, to fill me with Your Spirit. Give me the wisdom and the knowledge that I need to share with Your people, dear Father God. Place Your word on my lips that they may hear from You and not from me. I thank You for those who have come out tonight, and I thank You for those who are listening to this broadcast later on at their free, at their own appointed time, dear Father. I ask that if You would, please, to use Your word to enrich us, dear Father God, that we may be better than we were before. We thank You and we love You. In Jesus Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Amen. And thank God. Giving all honor and glory to our God and to our King. Much respect to our pastor, Reverend Dr. Jakari P. Davis. One day he gonna get sick of hearing that, but for the moment it's new for him. Yeah, and so I know that he don't mind hearing Reverend Dr. Jakari P. Davis. And to my good friend, yeah, Reverend Bobby D. Thomas, Pastor Bobby D. Thomas, I'm the Robin to his Batman. Yeah, and so don't never let him fool y'all. Yeah, he's Batman, and I'm Robin. Yeah, I'm Robin because my legs look better than his, but yeah, and Robin wears short, so I praise God, yeah, for my assignment as being the Robin to his Batman. Boy, y'all just don't know how many times God has linked us up throughout the years, even times when it was just unintentional. There would be some times where it would just be me and Bobby D. And so we just thank God for the way that He's meshed us together, even in this Bible study ministry. And to all my father's children, I just want to say good evening to you. Yeah, and I hope you had a good day. Yeah, and if you're feeling a little weary, remember the words that I told Brother Yarbrough, just find your wall and prop yourself up. Yeah, but leave one ear open. Yeah, so yet you might be able to absorb something that's being said on tonight. Yeah, all right, and so on tonight, As we always open up, you know, with the previous lesson review, and as usual, Pastor Thomas did his thing on last week. Even though I was absent in this place, I took advantage of watching the recording, and I was in my office just saying amen every step of the way. Yeah, and so we're still in our study guide, Multiply Disciples Making Disciples. And on on last week, Pastor Thomas started us off with part four of our study guide, which is understanding the Old Testament. When I first got saved, some of the worst advice that was given to me that I did not have to pay any attention to the Old Testament, just learn the New Testament. But then I found out as I was reading the New Testament that the New Testament quotes the Old Testament. So how can you ignore the Old Testament when the Old Testament is being quoted in the New Testament? God has a plan, and his plan is for us to know Old and New Testament scriptures. And so he started off with chapter one, and he started off with the creation, which was emphasized in Genesis 1 and chapter 2. And so in Genesis 1 and 1, it reminds us that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And we should, one of the things that we should know about our God is that not only is he the God that sits in heaven, but he's also our creator. Yeah, but I also like the way John 1 and verse 3 goes along with that, because it says all things were made through him, speaking about Jesus, and without him nothing was made that was made. And so if you do not see Jesus as your creator, then you believe in the wrong Jesus, because the scripture said that there was nothing made that was not made without him. And so you notice that I always take away what I call my personal PowerPoint. And the reason why I call it my personal PowerPoint, because the Bible says that there's nothing more powerful than the Word of God. And so anything that you learn in these Bible study lessons have to be a PowerPoint for you. One of the things that I'm going to continue to push is that you never leave out of this place without having at least one thing on your mind that you are meditating on, because it made that kind of impact to your life. And so my personal PowerPoint was that when Pastor Thomas said that the primary ingredient used to create the heavens and the earth was God's word. That's all God needed, was his word to create the heavens and the earth. And so I tagged along and said that if God had not said a word, then the heavens and the earth, including me, would not exist. The reason why you sitting here today is because God said a word, and his word included you. The Bible tells us that God formed us in the womb of our mothers. But before he formed us in the womb of our mothers, the Bible says that all of our members are written in his book. God wrote a book with a plan that he had to form you before he even formed you. And so we thank God that he had a plan, and I was included in that plan. I don't know about y'all, but sometimes I wake up and I'm glad that God didn't make me a dog. I'm glad that he didn't make me a chair. Yeah, I'm glad that he made me in his own image and likeness. And so you notice that I gave you Acts 17 and 28, because in Acts 17 and 28, it says that in him we live and move and we have our being. If God had not breathed into you, then you would not be sitting here on today. And so on tonight, we're going to part four of understanding. We're going back again to part four of understanding the Old Testament. But on tonight, we're going into chapter two. And chapter two of our study guide emphasizes the fall. And Francis Chan touches upon, he doesn't expound upon, but he touches upon Genesis chapter 3 through chapters 11. And you notice that I embolden the words of Genesis chapter 3, because the Bible says that God created in Genesis chapter 1 and 2, but it didn't take man long to mess everything up. Yeah. And so things began to fall apart as soon as we are three chapters deep into the book. And so on tonight, you see the three things that I want to touch on. I want to talk about the choice. I want to talk about the curse. But I want to talk about the continuity. And these are the three things that just stood out as I read the chapter. And so as you follow me with the commentary, it says that Francis Chan states in chapter 1 of part 4 that the Bible tells a story. And if we are going to effectively teach all nations to observe all that God has commanded, then we need to understand the story that is being told throughout the Old Testament. The story begins with God progressively creating all things. God chose to create all things in 6 days and rest on the seventh. And every step of the creation began with God saying a word, and nothing was declared to be good until God said so. And you notice whenever I embold something, I have a reason for embolding that. And the reason why I embolded the word good, because every time I read Genesis chapter 1 and I see what God says, it is good. I always wonder, because the Bible tells us that we serve a perfect God. And if we serve a perfect God, why would the thing that he created just declare it to be good? But there's a reason for that, and it's part of the story that is unfolding. And I believe that God declared things to be good because he knew that Genesis chapter 3 was coming. And he knew that man was going to tear things apart. And so the commentary goes on to say, but then things began to fall apart because Adam and Eve chose to go against what God had said. God said, do not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And that was the very thing that they chose to do. And it was in opposition to what God said not to do. I believe Chan says that when you go against what God said do, then you're in agreement with what the devil has said to do. And so we better be careful about the choices that we make, because the choices that we make are a representation of who we are in agreement with. And so I gave you Genesis chapter 2 and 17 and Genesis chapter 3 and 6, where we see God giving them the commandment, but things falling apart because Adam and Eve chose to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And a lot of people say, well, where was Adam? But that verse all tells us that Adam was right there with her. Adam witnessed all these things being done. And when he was handed the fruit to eat, the Bible said that he ate also. So he came into agreement with what the devil wanted as opposed to what God said do. And so the commentary goes on to say that whenever things seem to be falling apart in your life, look for the areas of your life where you have chosen to disobey what God has said or what he has said not to do. You know, the Bible calls this life a life of self-examination. And things don't just happen to us like the world would like to tell you. Sometimes we're instrumental in the things that happen to us. And sometimes things begin to fall apart in our lives because we have chosen to disobey God. A lot of people like to lie to themselves and say, well, you know, I'm just going through a test. Well, that ain't always true. Sometimes what you're going through is because you've disobeyed God. And that's why one of the things we have to ask God to help us do is to be honest with ourselves, so that we will be able to understand that everything that comes upon us isn't because I'm being tested. It's because I disobeyed God, and we are to take careful examination of the things that we do and choose to do in our lives. So turn your Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 5. 2 Timothy chapter 3. ignore that bell, that doesn't mean the class is over. 2 Timothy chapter 3, beginning at verse 1. And I'm waiting on pages to finish turning because I love for people to see it for themselves. And if you haven't been in 2 Timothy chapter 3 in a while, God has given us a wonderful invention called spit. So just spit on the end of your fingers and it will separate those pages for you. Amen. Amen. All right. Help him, Lord. Yeah. All right. So 2 Timothy chapter 3 reads this way. It says, "But know this, that in the last days perilous times will come." Some translators say that difficult times will come. Well, why do difficult times show up in our lives? Just keep reading. "For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal," which means that they're just cruel and evil, "despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power." And from such people we're supposed to do what? Turn away. And sometimes all of us have encountered some people just like this, haven't we? They have a form of godliness. They look good in church. Got their shiny shoes on, their nice suits, their best dresses. Can pray long prayers, but don't bit more no God than the man in the moon. And that's what it means by denying the power thereof. Because when we give your life to Jesus Christ, then God fills you with his power. And what that power does is it helps you to do what? To wipe away all the ungodliness that you used to perform in your life. The Bible says that if any man be in Christ Jesus, old things are supposed to pass away. And those old things are supposed to pass away as the ungodliness that we used to demonstrate and we used to live according to. But when it finishes by saying, "and from such people turn away," some of the reasons why difficult times come in our lives is because we hanging out with the wrong people. One of the best things that I did when I gave my life to Jesus Christ was separate myself from the ungodly friends that I was walking with. And boy, it was almost like life immediately began to get better because I separated myself from those who were leading me into ungodliness rather than helping me to walk away from ungodliness. And so, which is why I gave you 1 Corinthians 15 and 33 back on the handout. It says, "Do not be misled," because that's what ungodly people want to do. They want to mislead you. But we say, what? "Bad company corrupts good character." Some of us think that we are strong enough to change them. But 9 times out of 10, they'll end up changing us. Yeah, one of the things that I used to do, Brother Mike, is that I used to go down to the gym at NASA and shoot ball with those fellas at lunch. And one of the things I found out that I was cursing more than they would. But then guess what I had to do? I had to find me something else to do at lunch. Because what was happening to me? Bad company was corrupting the good character that God had designed for me. And I don't care how much you love or how much you like somebody, if they are causing your good character to become corrupted, then it's time for you to walk away. I've had to walk away from some family members that were corrupting my good character because they were doing what? They were misleading me and causing me to begin to go back to do the things that God had told me that I needed to separate myself from. And so do yourself a favor and separate yourself from folks who are misleading you. I don't care how much you like or love them. And so let's look at the takeaway. The takeaway says, when difficult times show up in my life, not only should I look for the areas of my life where I have failed to obey God, but I should also avoid people who try to influence me to behave in ways that displease God. And the reason why I gave you that bonus scripture, because that bonus scripture tells us that our primary aim and our primary goal should be to please God. Y'all know I've been singing that song for a while now. When anybody asks you, what is my purpose? I don't know my purpose. God has not shown me my purpose. Easy answer. Please God. No matter what situation you find yourself in, there will always be the answer to do what is pleasing in the sight of God. My Bible says that God sits on the throne of heaven and he sees the evil and he sees the good. Don't believe those lies that people tell you that your God cannot see evil. Because the Bible in black and white says that he sees the evil and the good. And anytime we participate in evil, you know who's looking right at you? God is looking at you. When my children were little, I took them outside and I told them, look up. And I said, guess who's looking right back at you? God is looking at you. And my hope was that that put the fear of God in them, so when daddy wasn't around, they'd always realize that God was always around. Did it work? Absolutely not. But I did my part. Yeah. Because they committed evil just like I did. But I pray for them every day. And I hope that one day they will completely turn their faces back to God. The saving grace that I have to remind myself is they young just like I was young. And was I fully serving God in my 30s? Absolutely not. But the same way that I finally decided to give my all to Jesus Christ, that is my prayer that they will begin to give their all to him as well. You know, we need to quit lying to ourselves about our children. Your children ain't the sweetest things you've ever seen in your life. Every time a baby is born into this world, y'all know what's born into this world? Another sinner. I remember when my brother's first child was born, and I went up to the hospital and I made this guy standing next to me mad as we was looking at the babies. And he was like, oh, look at them cute little babies. And I said, oh, well, another sinner has come into this world that needs Jesus. Yeah, y'all pray for me, because I'm one of the most blatant brothers you'll meet. But sometimes I'm blatant at the wrong time. But what I said was absolutely true. There is no child that was ever born into this world that did not need Jesus. Because Jesus came into this world to die for the sins of every one of us. And so let's look at the second outline, and let's look at the curse. Let's look at the curse. And so the commentary says, because of Adam and Eve's failure to obey what God had commanded, they began to live a cursed life rather than a blessed life. And I pointed you to Genesis 3:16 through 24 that gives us in black and white in God's word how Adam and Eve was cursed. The Bible said instead of the ground just giving what God wanted to supply, that Adam had to work hard by the sweat of his brow. And instead of Eve having an easy time in childbirth because of sin, she would now do what? Have pain in childbirth. And we know that that still exists today, which is the evidence that we all sinners, we all still got to work by the sweat of our brow. And women are still giving birth in full pain. And so the commentary goes on to say that rather than living the abundant life, they began to live the withering life. And in John 15 and 6, you do remember that Jesus commands us to abide in the vine. And if you do not abide in the vine, then you will begin to just wither. And so when you see people whose lives seem to just be withering away, that may be an indication that they are not abiding in Christ as God has commanded us to do. Commentary goes on to say that Pastor Darius Daniels emphasizes that God has created us to do more than just survive. He created us to thrive. If Jesus Christ came to give us life and life more abundant, that's more than a surviving life. God plans for us to do what? To thrive in this life. But to thrive in this life, you've got to do what? Do the things that God has commanded us to do. Commentary goes on to say that Adam and Eve began living the withering life because they allowed Satan's word to be the influence upon their lives rather than God's word. Chan points out that when the devil, and I put the serpent, because in Genesis chapter 3, it identifies him as the serpent, showed up in the garden. And the reason why I gave you Revelation chapter 12 and verse 9, because Revelation 12 and 9 says that that old serpent was the devil, who's also called Satan. So who Eve was actually listening to wasn't a serpent. She was actually in a conversation with the devil himself. And boy, I could teach on that for the rest of the night, because it's a whole lot of things that we understand wrong about Genesis chapter 3. The commentary said that the devil took what God said and twisted it. Satan's favorite version of scripture is the twisted word of God. Adam and Eve allowed the twisted word of God to influence them rather than allowing the pure word of God to be their guide. And what gets us in trouble is when we do not let the pure word of God be the guide to our lives, which is what it says in Proverbs 30 and 5. It says that every word of God is the pure word of God. Commentary says if we want to live the blessed, abundant, and thriving life that God intended for us, then we better make sure that what's guiding us is the pure word of God. And so turn with me to 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3. And for those using real Bibles, it sounds like a squeaky door hinge is opening up. Ain't been there in a while. 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 15 through 18. And if you seem to be flipping past it, do like I have to do from time to time and go to the table of content. God did us a favor when he allowed the editors to add the table of contents to our Bibles. You ever sat next to somebody and they were looking at the wrong book of the Bible? Because they was trying to pretend like we've all done it. Yeah, but I like to set people at ease and say, don't be ashamed to use your table of content, because when the preacher say Obadiah, Micah, Zechariah, guess where I'm going? To the table of content. Yeah. All right, so 2 Peter chapter 3, beginning at verse 15, it says, and consider that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation, as also our blood brother Peter, according to the wisdom given to him, has written to you. Now this is the apostle Peter acknowledging the ministry of the apostle Paul. Y'all remember back in when the apostle Paul first started his ministry, people had problems with Paul because he started out persecuting the church. But when he met Jesus on the Damascus Road, things began to change in his life. But people still mistrusted him. But here's the apostle Peter acknowledging the wisdom that God had given the apostle Paul. Verse 16 says, as also in all his epistles. What has he just justified? All of the epistles of the apostle Paul. He says, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things that are hard to understand. Anybody other than me from counting some things in scripture that was hard to understand? Well, guess what? You are not by yourself, because even the apostle Peter said that there were some things that were hard to understand. But what does he go on to say? He says, which untaught and unstable people, what do they do to it? They twist it to their own destruction, as they do also the rest of the scriptures. There are those who are among us who are called false preachers and prophets. And what makes them false preachers and prophets is that they twist the scriptures. Just because somebody comes up to you and says their name is Reverend such and such does not mean that they rightly divide the word of God. You may be the victim of somebody who will twist the scriptures. Verse 17 says, you therefore, beloved, since you know this beforehand, beware lest you also fall from your own steadfastness. What do these fake people who twist the scriptures, what do they desire to do? To cause you to fall from your steadfastness, being led away with the error of the wicked. But what does God want? But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. God did not call us to stay ignorant of the knowledge that he's given us. He wants us to grow in the knowledge that he has given us. There's an opportunity for us to grow every day based on what God has said in his word. It drives me nuts when people tell me that it's been 2-3 days since they opened up their Bible and looked at the word of God. I was like, then how are you living your life? What are you living your life based on? Because I open my Bible 2 or 3 times in a day. And you haven't opened your Bible in 2 or 3 days in a week? That's not what God wants for us. Every day is the opportunity to grow. And so he says, what does he say at the end of that? He says, to him be glory, both now and forever. So how is God glorified? When you grow in the knowledge of God. All right, and so let's go back to the paper. And so I gave you that familiar scripture, 2 Timothy 2:15. And Brother Mike, this is his favorite scripture. You're supposed to study to show thyself approved unto God. And notice I emboldened the word thyself. It's not Pastor Davis's responsibility to show you approved of God. That's your responsibility to show yourself approved of God. And you show yourself approved of God by doing what? Sticking your head in that Bible and studying what God has given us. How many times do people continually look at Facebook, continually look at Twitter, continually look at the TV, continue to play games on their phone, when all of those are opportunities that you could have opened up God's word and studied what God said? Boy, I heard a preacher say, if you can't say amen, then say ouch. But this is one of those times when it's supposed to hurt. God expects us all to study so that we will be what? Approved of God. It says, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, so that you will be able to rightly divide the word of truth. We expect Pastor Davis to rightly divide the word of truth. When you come here on Wednesday, on Tuesday night, you expect Pastor Thomas and myself to rightly divide it. But guess what? The same that you require of me, God also requires that of you. And so look at the takeaway. It says, we protect ourselves from the twisted word of God by studying the word of God for yourself. A lot of people like to say, that God has given us discernment, you know, but if you study discernment, you'll learn that you can't discern what you haven't already studied. The Bible isn't like a box of, what is it, Lucky Charms? It's not magical. You've got to study it. And then discernment will kick in, because discernment feeds off of what you've already studied. And so I gave you Acts 17:11, which is one of my favorite scriptures. because the Apostle Paul declares the Jews in Berea to be more noble than any other Jews that he had ever met, because no matter what he taught, they searched the scriptures to make sure that everything that he said was absolutely true. So I don't care how many degrees a man got behind his name, you open up your Bible and you make sure that everything that he says comes from the Word of God. God wrote a book and he expects for us to read it. And so finally, let's look at the continuity. Chan continues to describe how the biblical story is saturated with the effects of the fall. You cannot read the Bible without finding, running into somebody who has been affected by the fall. Only one man could say that he was not affected by the fall, and that was Jesus Christ. But in another way of thinking about it, you can say he was affected in some way, because he had to go to the cross for us. If the world had not been saturated in sin, then Jesus Christ would have never had to die on a cross. And so he goes on to say that the most devastating effect being the separation that sin causes between us and God, which is what Isaiah 59:2 says. The devastation that continues to exist even in this present day. Why? Because sin still exists. But Chan makes sure that we fully understand that even in the early stages of the biblical story, God had a plan to rescue and redeem a people for himself. And that's why we have Genesis 3:15. As soon as the first two people ever, whoever lived, existed in this world, God did what? Because they fell, he gave them his plan. And it's the plan that does what? That we are all grateful for. Scripture says that the serpent would bruise the heel of the seed of the woman, but the seed of the woman would crush the head of the serpent. And we know that's what Jesus Christ did on Calvary's cross. He crushed the head of the serpent. And so the rest of that says, which thanks be to God is a plan that also exists even unto this day. And so finally, turn your Bibles with me to Ephesians 1. Ephesians 1:7. It says, in him we have redemption through his blood. If Jesus Christ had not shed his blood, then we could not be redeemed. Well, what is that redemption? The forgiveness of our sins. The words that should be most precious to us from the cross when Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. It says that according to the what? The riches of his grace. Pastor Abraham taught us to watch every word, because if God had only had grace, then we'd be in trouble. But the scripture said that he was rich in grace. Verse 8 says, which he made to abound toward us all in wisdom and prudence, having made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself. The Bible said that it pleased God to bruise Jesus Christ, which was a purpose that he took upon himself. Verse 10 says that in the dispensation of the fullness of the times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on the earth in him, In him also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, that we who first trusted in Christ should be the praise of his glory. Once you trusted in Christ, God expects you to be the praise of his glory. Verse 13 says, in him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth. If you have not heard the word of truth, then you really don't trust God. I can't tell you what you trust in, but you don't trust in God if you have not developed that trust based on what God has said in his word. Do y'all know what an idol is? An idol is something that somebody has made up for themselves that came out of their own mind. And that's what we do when we do not trust in what God says in his word. We're making up a God in our own mind. And we expect him to do what we want him to do, as opposed to the thing that he said that he would be do according to his holy and righteous word. And so it says that that truth that you should have heard is the gospel of our salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. Verse 14, who is the guarantee of our inheritance? Once you receive God's Spirit, then guess what? You are guaranteed a place in heaven, or a place in God's kingdom. It's better said like that, because one of the things that we make too prevalent is the thought of going to heaven. But guess what the Bible teaches us? We aren't going to heaven. Heaven is coming here. Revelation chapter 21 said that the new Jerusalem came down because God was making his dwelling place among men. And so it says, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. All right. And so let's go to the takeaway. And the takeaway says, as teachers, remember, I told y'all that every last one of us is in full-time ministry. Jesus said in Matthew 28 that you're supposed to go unto all nations, teaching them to observe all that God has commanded. So you might not have a title, but you still in full-time ministry. Anytime you have the opportunity to teach what God has said in his word, then you're, guess what? You're exercising your ministry. And so as teachers of all that God has commanded, we need to be intimately familiar with the plan that God has always had. God always had the plan to send his son Jesus Christ, even before the foundations of the world. Y'all remember when I told y'all that in Genesis chapter 1, God declares everything good? And that's one of the reasons why I think that God didn't declare everything perfect, because he knew that we would fall, and he knew that he would have to send his son. And so it says he sent the plan that God has always had to redeem those who place their trust in Christ, because by no other name must a man be saved. And that's also found in Acts chapter 4:12. And so that's the choice, the curse, and the continuity. And one of the things we ought to be glad that God still continues is to seek and to save that which is lost. Because if he had stopped, he might have stopped at me. I know some of y'all were saved after me, so y'all would have been in trouble too. Yeah, but thank be to God that the plan continued. That means that my grandbabies got an opportunity to be saved. Because God would that all men be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. Amen? All right, let's pray. Our Father and our God, oh, how we thank you for this night. We thank you for the things that you've shared with us in your word on tonight. We thank you, dear Father God, that even though we've fallen short of your glory, that you were so loving and so rich and full of grace that you sent your son Jesus Christ to die for our sins so that we might be saved from eternal damnation. And so we thank you, dear Father God, for filling us with your Spirit, because we learned on tonight that your Holy Spirit seals us until the day of redemption. And so we're looking forward to that day, dear Father God, when we will live completely in peace and at rest with you. We love and praise you for all that you do. You're an awesome God. We love you and praise you. In Jesus Christ's name, we do pray. And all of God's kinfolk said, amen.